And I take this opportunity to welcome all of you, all the delegates from the ministry, all the ministries, those who are participating, Ministry of Home Affairs, National Disaster Authorities, the committee members, including ED and IDM, Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, and all the delegates who are participating. I extend my heartfelt thanks on behalf of the National Institute of Disaster Management in this particular webinar to join, that you have joined and ready to contribute. Before we start, just I give this handover to Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, Executive Director of NIDM, to say a few words in the opening and what he feels. He was also participated in that the first meeting, and today is the second meeting. So I request General Bindal to kindly take over, please.
Thank you, Dr. Santosh Kumar. First of all, heartiest welcome to all the participants. And I can see Professor V.K. Sharma, Kamal Kishore Ji, Krishna Vatsa Ji have joined, and many other dignitaries have joined who are all experts in their own field. And is the right forum for them to give out whatever is required to be revised in the Disaster Management Act. We are aware that this Disaster Management Act has proved to be quite useful in the current pandemic, when the center had to intervene across all the lists, whether it be concurrent list or the state list, and on subjects which were supposed to be a state subject. And then with number of disasters increasing and the intensity and frequency of disasters increasing, the question is there a need to make this Disaster Management Act 2005 more holistic, more inclusive? Keeping that in mind, two webinars are being conducted by NIDM to suggest to the working community as to what all needs to be, what is the need felt by the various experts who are in the field or who are in the various positions in various departments as to how this Disaster Management Act should be revised. Last webinar, which was on 4th, in that, a few things came out very loud and clear. First was that the definition of disaster needs to be expanded so that it includes public health and other disasters. Second was that the role of various institutions and their linkages with the government function, parallel government departments needs to be formalized properly. The third issue which came out was that there needs to be an institutional framework below district level, at tehsil level, because the maximum work goes on there. Whatever we do, like it is a very common thing to say that disasters are global, but our responses are local. So this local thing is stopping at the district, which is a very vast area. And to reach to the last man, there's a need, maybe there's a need to put in another institutional framework at tehsil level or whichever way. That is, an SDRF issue came out, their roles and responsibilities, SDMAs, their roles and responsibilities, and their in linkages with the state government departments. Then multi-stakeholder engagement. In this, everyone pointed out about taking on board the civil society organizations, the NGOs, the various local bodies, the community, because they are a major factor. They are a major factor in action on ground, but they don't have a seat. They don't have a seat on the table. So maybe this Disaster Management Act should work out a mechanism that they also are part of the in the participatory planning process at every level. Financing issues were also brought out, and we had professors from Insurance Institute of India also, who brought out a number of relevant issues on this subject. And inclusiveness, this was again a major takeaway that many of the participants felt, that the inclusiveness of various communities, inclusiveness of the persons with disabilities, of the marginalized, of the weak, and inclusiveness of animals, whether it be livestock or otherwise, should be also mentioned somewhere in the Disaster Management Act. So I've given in a gist the major things which were discussed, so that we do not waste time on discussing those issues again, we would be interested in that you give the participants give out more issues which can be included or not included, and we're looking for specific recommendations so that we can capture that particular suggestion in the right context and not lose the context in which it was said. So I once again thank all the participants for joining in, and we're looking forward to a good 2 hours, good interactive session, whereby not many good ideas will come out. Thank you so much. Over to you, Professor Santosh.
Thank you. Thank you very much, General Bindal, for this opening remarks that what we did discuss there during that time and what were the key recommendations which came on the floor and which we have also listed it out. And this is important to start that from where we should begin today. And initially we were thinking that we should have chapter wise section one to definition to definition, then move on. But it was also important to discuss that last time we could not have this much of the civil society input. Most of the inputs came from the government and the state government and the people who are into the draft committee. So maybe we can start with today, the deliberations which had happened and not to repeat on that. You all are aware about the Disaster Management Act 2005, and you are also aware about that the task force recommendations which were given in 2013. And we are also facing all the different disasters along with the COVID-19. So in this context, I would request first intervention from the civil society or this academia. We can see that Professor Janki Andharia is there. But after Janki Andharia, I would request Professor V.K. Sharma to give this state perspective on what she's saying. But Janki Andharia and one or two more civil society group members I will take up. But before that, I hand it over to Professor Janki Andharia. I just wish to know about this, any intervention from NDMA, if anybody is willing to, at this point of time, like to intervene, or we should move ahead. We have permission from the NDMA. National Disaster.
Santosh, you have full permission to move ahead. I just want to make one comment, which is that, you know, the conversation we had on Saturday was immensely useful, and I'm looking forward to this discussion as well. There is just one point which is sort of which sort of builds on what we discussed on Saturday, that there are many things that we wish to see in the act. But we have to differentiate between what goes into the act as something which provides an enabling condition and a framework for enforcement, for accountability. And there are many things which need to change from time to time as new needs are felt. Those things go as rules and regulations. So when colleagues make comments, I think it will be good to keep that distinction. You know, as to what is it that is a sort of legislative arrangement, a legal arrangement, and what is it that is an expansion on legal arrangements, and that goes into rules and regulations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kamal Kishoreji, for giving us initial a kind of underlining things that how we should move ahead today. That how we can make a clear-cut distinction that where we should go, whether it's we should form the part of the Act amendment, or we should form the larger framework of the Act, or it should go as a rules and regulations instead of attacking on the basic skeleton of the. So all these to be seen in the context of the DM Act and task force and also the current situation. So now I would request Professor Janki Andharia to start with the initial comment. Maybe we can come back to you again when you formulate your ideas. Professor Janki Andharia, if you are listening to me, please.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, Janki Andharia, you all know that she is teaching at Tata Institute of Social Science and the Disaster Management Center she is heading. and she has been working for long in the disaster mitigation. Jan Kendariya ji, please.
Thank you very much for this invitation. I more than comments, I thought I would need some clarifications about the fact that, you know, what has happened to the task force report, and why are we looking at the revision at this stage? You know, I mean, there is 2013 task force report, which has provided several recommendations. So are we looking at revisiting those recommendations, or are we looking at adding on, or, I mean, what is the sort of broad status and process that we are going through, just so that one understands the backdrop under which this whole revision is being revisited? Can somebody explain that a little bit? That will be useful. Maybe someone from NDMA.
I think Mr. Jindal from MHA would be better positioned to respond to that. But quickly, there is no revision of revision because there was no revision. So it's basically building on the work that has been done, not just the task force report, but the work that was done prior to that also, even before the act came into being, the high-powered committee report. And a lot of lessons that we have learned since 2013, when the task force report came, the lessons that we've learned in the context of current pandemic as well. So it's not revisiting those recommendations necessarily, but actually building on them and expanding on them.
Thank you very much for clarifying this to Professor Jan Kendariya. I hope you are clear, Professor Andaria.
I endorse the view comments of Mr. Kamal Kishore. The task force report, most of the recommendation have already been accepted by the government, and to build upon the changes taking place thereafter, and the pandemic situation which we are facing now. So this is the context we need to having a relook on the provisions of the DMA now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jindal. He's from Ministry of Home Affairs, Joint Secretary, and he has also clarified the position that what is there. So both member, Mr. Kamal Kishore and Mr. Jindal have given the as a kind of an idea. Now, if Professor Jan Kendariya, if you are to immediately react on this, comprehend, then we will come back to you later. But or you wish to say something here, then we will move to Professor V.K. Sharma.
Yeah, we can move to Professor V.K. Sharma.
No, okay.
Thank you.
Okay, Professor V.K. Sharma, please, welcome you, sir, from you are the vice chairman, and you have been involved in all through and through high-powered committee to the formation of the act and also execution of the act at the state level. So Professor V.K. Sharma, please.
Thank you very much, Professor Santosh. And first of all, I will compliment you and NIDM, you know, for initiating this discussion, which is very much required. Because the act came in 2005 and now it is 15 years. So I think this is the right time that we all should discuss, you know, that whether it need amendment, you know, and what amendment required. I attended some of the meetings of the task force as well. And I appreciate, you know, Dr. P.K. Mishra did wonderful job. He invited, you know, many experts, myself, Shri Anil Sinhaji, who is also in this webinar. We both, you know, were invited as a special invitee. Mr. Krishnawats was there, you know, in one or two things. And I think we discussed, you know, a lot on in this task force meeting also. And on many points, we were not with him. We were having our own view. But doesn't matter, you know, that is that was the process. In fact, you rightly said that this was started long back when there was high-powered committee, and we were having we had a lot of discussion on this part, you know, that what should be the structure, and about act also. We gave a model act, you know, in the high-powered committee report. And that model act was not just by the members. In fact, we discussed it with many practitioners. We had one meeting only on act, you know, in Bhopal, and invited many senior bureaucrats, some chief secretaries, and I think very, very good discussion. And then we came out with some draft act. Then finally, in after tsunami, I think this act came in 2005, which was very, I mean, everybody appreciated this because we were not having any anything before that. I mean, so I think that was the welcome thing, and we really appreciate Government of India that ultimately something was there, you know, to start with. But now 15 years, and we have a lot of experience today. I am sorry that I couldn't attend on Saturday. I missed that because I couldn't join because there was no electricity in this sector that day. So it doesn't matter, my loss. But I will say that I'm working now in the state of Sikkim. So my intervention will be in two parts. One is that at the state level, you know, what is required and what can be, in case there is amendment, then what should be the focus. This is one. Second thing is that the task force, you know, the report of the task force, and I'm glad that it is being accepted. And but few points, you know, which we that time also we were not of this opinion, and today also we have the same opinion, and I will just highlight those. So first of all, at a state level, I think some of the state, they took it very seriously. And today you can see that and these states are known to all of you that they have a full-fledged state disaster management authority, and it's working like an authority. Rest of the state, they couldn't take it that seriously. So I think there should be a very clear-cut direction from in the act that you know, this structure should be there, and this should be the status of a state disaster management authority. District disaster management authority, which is a key basically for disaster risk reduction, and this is the weakest part. Shri Anil Sinha, he was also vice chairman in Bihar for a long time, and he will bear with me that district, you know, where all the actions are being taken, that is the weakest link. You know, the district magistrate is, and the public representative, you know, both are co-chairing, and I don't see that seriousness, you know, which is required at district level. So we tried in our state, you know, that there should be some formal arrangement. There should be some regular meetings, you know, of the DDMA. And then we realized that there is another important thing which is completely missing. That is the local self-government, you know, the urban local bodies, the panchayats. They are not having any place. There is no place for NGOs, civil society. And I think this is major gap, you know, which we realize in a few years. And I'm sure that when we will revisit this thing, when we will see that what should be done, I think these are some of the points which will be taken much seriously. Another point, yeah. Just 1 or 2 minutes, I will finish. Yeah. One more point, that the ministries, again the same thing, that in the center as well as in the state, the central government, some of the ministry has.
Possible.
Santosh ji, kindly ask the participant to mute, otherwise this echo will come and we will not be able to discuss.
I request all the participant delegates to kindly mute their mics so that we can listen to the speaker, please. Thank you so much for the cooperation extended. Thank you.
So second thing is the ministry. Some of the ministries in central government, you know, they are taking it very seriously. They have their, you know, plan and everything. They are engaged in it. They are, and same thing is in the state government. Some of the departments, you know, they are very serious about it. But I think in case we want to have really disaster risk reduction, then the mainstreaming is the main thing. This is the central theme. And in case we want to achieve it, you know, there should be more engagement of ministries and departments. So this is another point. I will come to the task force. There are two, three points and then I will stop. Our very important point was about the position of the members. I think degrading the position of members, we always oppose that, you know. And we tried to convince Dr. Mishra that, you know, in case you make it secretary level, this thing, then I think the members will not be that effective as they are today. So anyway, I mean, there is it's one point which was discussed, but anyway, people couldn't convince with us. Number was another point because the country is so big. The number of disaster is 33, 34. Now it is pandemic, you know, which is a, you can imagine that in case you reduce the number of members, I think that is not proper. And we opposed that, you know, that time also, that the number may be increased, but not should be decreased. Another point was NIDM. You are creating National Institute of Disaster Management and you are making mockery of it. It should be autonomous. And in case it is not autonomous, in case there is no autonomy to NIDM, then this institute has no meaning. I think this point was, and even in the last day when this meeting was there in Vigyan Bhavan, I said this thing very clearly to Dr. P.K. Mishra. He said, you reconsider this point. NIDM should be under Ministry of Home Affairs. There is no problem. But it should be completely autonomous. And this autonomy, in case you take it, then I think this cannot perform as national institution. And again, I am saying that in case there is revision, I think we should see it to this. And because now you are having one more branch, which is in South. So I think these are some of the things which we discussed already. And we were not, you know, with the opinion of the chairperson, but we said it in black and white. And in every meeting, you know, we advocated for this thing. Last point is the civil society and gender issue. I think the women, I think this is one very important thing. And now people have realized, you know, that the gender, you will not see it anywhere, you know. I think this is very important point, the role of women and their leadership and this thing in disaster management. This is very important and it is not taken care by neither by task force nor in the act. So I think we have many learned people who are attending this webinar. In fact, I am here to listen because I am speaking since last 30 years and nobody is listening to me. So now I want to listen to others so that I gain some knowledge and I correct myself because I feel that my points may not be correct. That's why nobody is listening to me.
But no, thank you very much, sir, that point which you have put forward. At the point that at last experience, you put your point to academia also, your engagement in the sector for long, and also you put the state perspective that how the state are feeling the problem, the structure you suggested, and also the role urban local body, panchayat, and address the NIDM issues and also civil society and gender issues. In the first segment, we are taking as a academia, and then second segment, we will take up the civil society, because these two are very, very important, as that then we will listen to the government also to quickly, and especially the legal section, the Ministry of Law and Justice. Another academia here. Okay. Okay, you please go ahead. And be brief in your point, please.
Absolutely. I will not say a word
more than that. No, important is this.
Okay, no, I want to make 3 points. The first point is that we need to see either in the Act or in rules and regulations the connection between disasters and development. So we have a scenario in this country where a large number of development decisions are actually enhancing disaster risks and creating more disasters. And if we are not going to belabor this point, nobody is going to do it. So I think the folks who are within the disaster sector, to say, need to bring it on board. We know what has happened with regard to large projects and environment impact assessments. So there is one sort of view which says we need to have for every project clearance some understanding about how that particular project speaks to disasters. What is it passing disasters? I don't know whether that would be the right way, but we need to think of what would be the most appropriate way to bring in these linkages, because on the one hand, we are investing in development. On the other hand, a lot of our development gains are being wiped out by disasters because of faulty development decisions, which are completely unmindful of how risks are being enhanced. So I think it needs some thinking through. I don't have one single clause to sort of add to say, isko add kar do to ho jayega. We need to think this through.
You're not visible. Your connection probably is a. Please check the connection, Professor Janaki.
There you are.
Yeah, please. It's now we are listening. Go ahead.
Am I?
Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah, please complete.
I think it's also with the way the government understands disasters, that it continues to be, all the action to be response-centric. We are not at all proactive. It's only after a disaster occurs that we sort of start talking about what is to be done. This brings me to the second point, which is one of accountability. Government institutions classically do not demonstrate any accountability, and I think the losses that we incur in disasters.
Not getting the voice.
Maybe I will give you this in writing. The second issue is one of accountability of institutions that are responsible for disaster management. So we need to build in accountability mechanisms, because we have seen, I think, enough examples which demonstrate that funds are being frittered away with zero accountability, no reporting, no sort of, I think it's scandalous. I'm being very, very direct. It is absolutely scandalous that we are just wasting funds and with no output. So we need to look at how best can we ensure accountability within institutions of disaster management. And as somebody rightly pointed out, that it's kind of top heavy, district and above, and nothing sort of at the lower level. So I think we need some discussion on that, or we need to sort of create mechanisms to enhance this accountability. Should we have punitive measures? I think that's something that, again, we need to discuss. Should there be, when we talk of accountability, it very often rings hollow. And as long as some report is submitted, we think that's accountability. We need to actually demonstrate and show how certain actions have actually helped reduce disasters, reduce the impact of disasters, and so on. So I think it's again linked to being highly response-centric rather than proactive. So I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Andharia, for giving insight. And in terms of everybody has listened, so I will not report. I will try to get others' viewpoint. I don't know, Professor Ravi Sinha is there, if I believe he is there. You are representing another academia, technical institution and all, and you have been engaged in the disaster management for long. So deliberations, you are listening, and you were there on the other day also. Which we could not take your view on that particular day on the 4th July. Can you, in that context, you can put a very specific that what kind of a changes we need to have?
Thanks, Santosh. And it's really, first of all, I would again echo the other speakers in congratulating NIDM for taking up this very important discussion. As they say that a lot of water has flown down the river in the last 15 years. We have a huge wealth of experience, not just in terms of what has happened, but also in terms of what has not happened, and colloquially, why something which could have happened has not happened. So specifically in the context of possible modifications in the Act itself, I would like to just go back and reiterate what is known to all of us, that from a governance point of view, we require the legal mechanisms. We require the institutional arrangements, and then we require the functional arrangements to implement the legal mechanisms. So it's the legal mechanisms and part of the institutional arrangements which are statutory, which are through law, and remaining can be through the rules or through the executive order. So specifically focusing on the legal arrangements and the institutional mechanisms which are required to implement them, which are required statutorily, I would like to highlight only a few points. First of all, we seem to be doing much better in response than in other mandates of the Disaster Management Act, which are to make us less response-centric and more mitigation and preparedness-centric. And it shows a lacuna which is there flowing right from the institutional mechanisms itself, which are existing, that we are not able to bring them the way the Act envisioned and the way which society and the country needs. So what I see is that we need to have a statutory strengthening of statutory institutions, either the current institutions which are in place, or we require even creating new statutory institutions in maybe niche areas. With the institution will come the very big gap, which is there right now and which is related to human resources, that we have a very vast cadre of human resources which can be drawn for response, like we are seeing right now from various bodies of the government as well as from the other parts of the society. But there has to be a small core of people who live and breathe disaster risk management, disaster risk reduction. And this has to be statutorily mandated. Otherwise, it won't be possible to create these kinds of people. Because obviously, their need is felt only when we are facing a disaster and when we are in what is normally known as the phase zero, when we don't have an ongoing disaster, suddenly these people are not felt necessary. And if they are part-timers, they will move over to other jobs instead of strengthening the disaster risk management while preparing for the future disaster. So this is one point I would like to make, that we need to revisit the institutional arrangements and see whether the existing institutions which are given in the Act need to be strengthened, and where there are additional institutions which are required to be created on the basis of the experience we have drawn. The second point, and which was also mandated or mentioned by the other speakers, is which is also a mandate of the Disaster Management Act, is to learn lessons from disasters. And learning lesson is not just a reporting. Learning lesson goes far deeper than that. And again, if we don't have a statutory mechanism of learning lessons, then we are really not learning. We are just reporting at a very superficial level. So that, again, I feel is something which goes into the Act instead of the rules and regulations. So these are two key points I would like to suggest for consideration and for discussion. Thank you.
Professor Sinha, for a very insightful remark. Now we also request, I think Dr. Sunita Reddy is here. Lady voice, we must have heard as a lady expert that women issues were flagged in the beginning itself. And last time also it was discussed. So she might be having different perspective, and we have listened to Janki and Dharia. And Professor Reddy, would you like? But I would request you to be brief, please.
Thank you so much.
And a specific too.
Thank you so much, Professor Santosh Kumar. I'll be very brief and specific. I've gone through all the points of the Management Act, DM Act, and also the report of task force. So I have put down the points along with the numbers so that I'll be reading it very quickly so that all the points can be covered. And if I can close the video so that it's easier for the bandwidth. So starting with the DM Act 2005 definitions 2A, where we call affected area and affected part of the country. So now we can see with COVID-19 that it's not just the part of, if we can add on entire globe, because we also go beyond national boundaries to help others. So under definitions, affected area can be a little more elaborated. Then definition of disaster. We have put natural in, if we can put natural disaster, natural under quotes. A lot of literature which talks about that there is nothing natural because they're all natural events and phenomenon and becomes a disaster with the interface of humans. So thereby it more of anthropogenic. So we can further look into the definition of disaster. And as others said, if we can add livestock, which are very important for livelihoods, and also animals, both domestic and wild animals, because we see every year Kajiranga's experience. Another beyond coping capacity of community. Now we have seen again with pandemic that it's not just the community, but it can go beyond the coping capacity of nations. So if we can add on after community, district, state, and nations, and where we also seek help and also give help in terms of national disasters, and we have been helping to Japan as a case. Chapter 261, National Authority for Laying Down Policies, Plans, and Guidelines for Disaster Management. Now the whole term management is often written. We can add on because management working in a holistic sense and a cyclic approach, it's well and good, but even then to talk of preparedness, and under COVID examples also, we can see that we need to have preparedness for future. So guidelines for disasters, management, and preparedness. Then 8.2b, if we can add, apart from the departments we have mentioned, education, public health, and medical. Because health is a very broad, and under health, again, we can divide them into public health and medicine or medical, which needs to be added. Chapter 322.2, after C point, we can say lay down guidelines for preparation of DM plans by the departments of government of state and district authorities. We have not talked anywhere about the private sector. If we can also write guidelines for the role of private sector and especially private health sector, private health service sector, and also voluntary organizations, NGOs, CBOs, as volunteers. I think these are very important, which others also have highlighted. Chapter 3A, the vulnerability of different parts of the state to different forms of disaster. If we can add vulnerable population, where women, pregnant and lactating mothers, elderly, chronically ill, differentially abled, terminally ill, children, from their EMIC perspective, because when we look at the disasters from the individual point of view, then we on to these vulnerable groups facing multi-hazards. example, if we can say lactating pregnant mothers, currently COVID and Assam floods, how, what kind of problems they face, what kind of risk they face, and if we can plan from bottom up. Then chapter 3, we can talk of disseminate information to deal with threat, treat disaster situation or disasters. So now we have not mentioned who is going to give information to public. And if we can also have a clear media and communication cell instituted in each department to give clear and local language, vernacular language, and IEC in normal times and also disaster times to avoid any rumors, misinformation, and news. So understand where all we can put in the media component, having a set dedicated for the information in normal and also during disasters. Chapter 432, sixth point, laid down guidelines for prevention of disaster management plans. The sentence is not really clear. Guidelines for prevention of disaster management plans, I think we have to look into it, by the Department of the Government at the district and local authorities in district. So if we can go down to block and panchayat level, including vulnerable sections, that's been already stated. And also to bring in rule book where we talk of monitoring, review, these are the terms which are often there, but then who's going to do the monitoring, who's going to do the review, and who will do all these processes, that needs to be mentioned. 34G of chapter 4, make arrangement for disposable of unclaimed. Now, it's not just unclaimed dead bodies. It's very important to look into disposing of dead in any disasters. And if we can add further that handing over dead to the next of the kin, performing last rites, dignified burial in case of pandemics, which we have seen a very important part of mental health for the families. Chapter 6, local authorities. Under that, 41.2. The local authorities may take such other measures or may be necessary to disaster management. If we can add TOT, training of trainers, capacity building, volunteer teachers under school preparedness in disaster management, paramedic staff, health staff for regular training and mock drills. Chapter 8, mention of SCDRF and all, SDRF and roles and responsibilities of NDRF and SDRF, and also further coordination between the two. That also needs to be mentioned. Chapter 11, we have given miscellaneous as a chapter, but I think this is very important. It needs to be taken as another chapter where it should be made into a complete chapter looking at the socio-cultural and psychological aspects. 61 points talks about compensation for relief. If we can also add on the financial aspects of both rehabilitation and reconstruction. Further, there are two places we have used the word victim. I think that talks about helplessness. We should be changing it with survivors because that's more adding to the agency of the people. And further, if we are talking about no discrimination, we have whatever is there, we can further add on class, ethnicity, age. Age factor is also very important. And the end, we have also talked about the resources, the point 65.3a. We talk of resources includes men as material resource. So it's not just men, as Vinod G had mentioned, resource includes men, women, and also third gender. And I feel even children are very resourceful. So we have to think about that. And 65.3b, services includes facilities. Now, I am not really sure whether services include facilities. Services are services, and facilities are different. That needs a clarification. And also compensation disbursement should be time-bound and not endlessly going on. So there we have to somewhere mention about the duration of giving compensation. Mention of guidelines for inclusion and exclusion. Whenever there is a disaster, we keep thinking whom to give, allow them to do volunteerism or humanitarian agencies. So we need to have some criteria of inclusion, exclusion, right in the beginning itself, as to blacklisted and others will not be given permission, and so that it's clear. and guidelines for international goodwill and relief and rehabilitation for others where India can help. And I'll take just 2-3 more minutes to report on the task force review of DM Act 2005. The point 8.2.1 should have 9 members, which has been reduced. I also very strongly feel that given the vast country with diverse and multiple hazards, ministries for home, defense, finance, and agriculture are there, and urban development is there. If we can also have the ministries of rural development, women and child development, because majority of the population, both women and child constitute, and health should be added. Then 8.2.2, the member about the members, we should also mention that the experts, area of experts should be there. Like there should be mix of experts coming from multidisciplinary teams, social scientists, doctors, CBRN specialists, engineers, defense services, management, economists, sociologists, anthropologists, and the term, 5 years term, and there can be a rotation. Next point is 8.6.2, where rotation of NDRF already exists. We had a recent discussion with KM Singhji, where there is, I think, 20% being rotated, so there is a continuity. 8.7.4, state government may have the discretion to appoint not more than 2 full-time members. I think states like Assam, Bihar, UP, and coastal states need more members, so it should be left to the discretion of the states. 8.10.2, limited to ensuring construction projects. Now, very important that we need to look into the past experiences of disasters. We have to add maintenance also, not just the construction, but maintenance. Maybe this may be in collaboration with other departments, but we have to look into the condemnation and also demolition of unsuitable structures, not just building, because it's only written building. We have to write down about bridges, dams, runways, railway tracks, roads. Road accidents and deaths are the major cause for the deaths in the country. And not just compliance with laws and codes and rules, but relating to building safety, fire safety, but also all transport safety. Further factories, factories in coordination with concerned ministries and departments. So yearly monitoring and assessment, especially reference to cities and urban flooding and pollution, is not yet added into this. 8.11.7, the on-site and off-site emergency plans of major biological, chemical, nuclear, and radiological units be monitored, assessed, mock drill with the community, and preparedness of fire, health center, volunteerism in the vicinity. And last 2 points, 8.13.1, NDMA should meet with whom? It's not written meeting, with its own members or with the state authorities. Should be done maybe quarterly or visit to the states, whichever is facing disaster. That may be the practice already, but if that can be mentioned in the document. 8.14.6 should be provisions for grievances redress mechanisms in the context of relief, rehabilitation, reconstruction. Maybe a toll-free number for the control room or at the disaster center would be important. And the last point, 8.16, human resource national cadre is mentioned of DM professionals. So these national cadre can be included with DM professionals, public health professionals, and also social workers, which combine together a good force. And having an very important is convergence and intersectoral coordination between different ministries at all different levels. So these are some of my quick points.
Thank you very much, Dr. Reddy. You have given a very elaborate. I would request you to kindly send us the document which you have written already with section by section. I was going through the text also, but it was difficult to chase you with this point-wise point, but I would request to kindly send us, that would be, we are grateful to you.
Maybe a final...
Now, friends, this...
Finally, read a friendly
document. You have a final point?
I'm saying the DM Act, okay, which is very old, if we can have a reader-friendly document finally when it is done. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. A legal document is always complex, but we need to go for the people's perspective. I would request now, this is a segment which we had and a lot of community things which have been talked about. And we also discussed about this particular thing we are doing in terms of bringing this COVID into perspective. And Dr. Vatsa highlighted that day and 5-6 points just to inform you about, this is a very definitional issue he also pointed out, and also pointed out about the comprehensive and more people-oriented, the government's perspective is that how we are making it more people-oriented. Also included human capital of private sector and also the government sector. So that human capital and other resources to be combined along with the government with the resource crunch which we found. And also 15th Finance Commission, he gave a very, very pertinent emphasis on that, that how this goes seamlessly integrated along with the community and other things. The new thing which has come up as a disaster mitigation fund. So giving you this perspective and what was highlighted and discussed also, before we go to the segment of the civil society, if they wish to hear, they are here. I wish to invite a doctor when we are talking about the COVID-19 in the context. And one of the doctor is here and also public health person here, the expert and the delegates, Mr. Sethi. Are you there on the board? Can you quick points in terms of the act which you would like to add here? Probably he's not here. No problem. Now we will have a this from civil society. Civil society. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So now we are going to invite any Dr. person. Who?
Naveen Sethi.
I requested him to please pitch in and quickly.
Yeah, sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Please.
Sir, apologies. My net is today is problematic. So I want to just emphasize the role of private sector and the, as Dr. Reddy said, that pandemic should be included in the disaster. And there is a very huge role of private sector in the disaster management. So I would emphasize that there should be role of the private sector, healthcare organizations in the disaster management, basically, because they play a very important role in pandemics and relief work, actually. Because disaster management act is written well, but the how part is somewhat missing for the private sector and the other sectors, actually. So this is my humble submission.
Please recommend. Hello? Any specific suggestion you wish to make here?
Yeah, there should be representation of private sector in the disaster management committees, which is in the district as well as state. So
okay.
That becomes a holistic approach, because there is a lot of buzz around private-public partnership nowadays. So
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I request from the civil society how they see that the issues which I just suggested. Ms. Pooja Marwa, you want to say something?
Yes, sorry.
You're raising your hand. Yeah, please. You put off your video and then make a point.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Ah, okay. Hi, I represent Child Rights in you. And, I have not studied the one key thing we found in disasters that needs to be done is that, you know, this time also, for example, we all went to the national, the NDE, site and had to register ourselves, etc. Right? So again, during, I don't know if it should be in the act, it should be in the rules and regulations, but this needs to be far easier for smaller organizations to do. Like for larger organizations, so at maybe how to ensure that everybody who's working in the disaster is registering themselves? Because I know for a fact that there are hundreds and thousands of small organizations, right, who may be only working at the block level, at the district level, maybe even village level, a way to bind them all together. Yeah? So to me, one of the key problems that happens is that we duplicate each other's efforts. Right? So if government is doing X, then this should not be something civil society should be doing. Right? So, and there should also be a way to contribute in a very, so we know, for example, does government need, right now I'm thinking of the situation, do they need PPE? Do they need masks? Yeah, and if there is a space where this can be sort of dialogue, then everybody will not be duplicating, complementing each other's role.
So are you through, ma'am?
Yes, I'm through.
Okay, thank you very much for giving the suggestion. Now, request from Sphere India.
Yeah. So, sir, in terms of the structure, I think I will not repeat, but endorse the views from others that the inclusion of urban local bodies, panchayats, NGOs, other non-government stakeholders, including private sector, and also the points already mentioned by Professor V.K. Sharma in terms of the number of members and the status of members. I think COVID reality has given us learning to rethink and revisit that. So I endorse those points, sir, first of all. Secondly, sir, in my experience, what we see that what ACT has achieved beautifully is the vertical structure which has come up from the NDMA, SDMA, DDMA, and their enablement and to a large degree, and what they have been able to do through this structure. But where do I see is perhaps more either detailed rules or operational guidelines need to be there for the horizontal coordination, that is interdepartmental coordination, whether it's happening through the working of the executive committee structures, the national executive committee, state executive committee, district committee, and even going beyond that, if we are going a level below, so what kind of executive committee comes there? So that these executive committees, we come up the interdepartmental coordination between various departments, and that needed to be more pronounced. I would say that what we've seen from the COVID reality, the role which civil society stakeholders have played, the non-government stakeholders have played is a big takeaway, sir. So I would like to make a recommendation that in all these structures, from the national to the absolutely local, there should be some involvement of civil society organizations in the interdepartmental coordination, sir. And that's certainly one area to strengthen in our working, sir, whether it happens as part of operational guidelines or it happens through restructuring within the act is, I think I can leave it for the people who are working on that. The other aspect of it is that, in the COVID reality, sir, we see that the multiplicity of institutions. So will it be Niti Aayog, MHA, or the PMO or NDMA? I think there has been some lot of confusion around that. I think we saw in the COVID reality Niti Aayog coming up and playing a really big role. But do we envision this kind of a role? Have we envisioned it in the act? Or if we learning from now required that? So, or are we linking it with the crisis management group and other structures which we are seeing in institutional mechanism? Perhaps again in the act or the plan, I think some clarity need to be there on these ones. Otherwise, it gets a little bit confusing, sir. In terms of the role of NGO and other stakeholders, I think the non-private stakeholders, I think including the private sector, there has been the view inputs from others. I'll again reinforce that point. Interdepartmental coordination, sir, which I was saying about the NEC, it should not remain limited to the emergencies, but we see that how these the departments respective development plans and how we mainstreaming DRR, including climate risk in those development plans, that kind of a coordination and having it at a very periodic level, at least on a quarterly basis, something clearly seen that how the way departmental plans and some flagship schemes are working and how the coordination is happening among them, also including the DRR mainstream features, that is another thing. Sir, we see that the act, the provision for the minimum standards of relief. Again, we do have a guideline, but that guideline perhaps required to be more detailed out. It's very, very skeletal as of now. It's not really specifying the standards. It's just giving some kind of intent. So if we have a more detailed guideline, it perhaps will give more material to states. And also we see that, you know, we achieve them as a states. It has remained pending for long. A couple of other policy guidelines in some of community-based disaster reduction and the role of NGOs, which have remained pending. We see that probably some of them are moving forward now. I think that's also remains the points of recommendation. And my last bit would be on the accountability. Though Prof. Janki has made a broad point about that, it's more about bringing the accountability mechanism within the act. What all things could be included into that in terms of including grievance redressal or listening to communities, listening to people, the feedback mechanism, how real-time feedback from the affected communities can be collected and that be utilized by the structure right from the NDMA, SDMA, DDMA downwards. Some things, features like this, if this can be pronounced, there are a lot of good practice available on these things, so that I strongly support this point. These are a few views from me, sir. I will do a more detailed one.
Thank you very much. Just I wanted one more point from you. Anything on long-term recovery, reconstruction and financing? Anything, because you have a civil society groups with you working. Any specific suggestion on the 15th Finance Commission recommendation on inclusion in this?
Yes, sir. What we again see is in terms of a response and others, there is a lot of finance which comes from the private and the government and the non-government sector, including the private one. It's the recovery essentially, you know, which is where these finances, financing and financing models are not available, at least to the civil society stakeholders, in spite of their strong capacities in India, perhaps there's a lot of struggle is around there in terms of finances available to take that forward. So I'd like to make a recommendation that in the financial provisions, you know, we look at the partnerships with the civil society and include mechanisms like now, for example, we have got PM CARES. So there's a very good mobilization of resources which have happened over there. So can there be the provisions like civil society organizations partner with the PM CARES funds and other CARES funds through which, you know, a more inclusive reach can be made, especially where we see that the government system at the local level spreads thin and civil society.
Vikrant, I would stop you here. I would just suggest you, since you are coordinating with large number of civil society groups, so I would request you to give your recommendation also in a specific in writing to us. That would be very useful for formulating our own viewpoint for sending it to the committee. Thank you very much.
Very soon.
Thank you very much. Now I would request, since many of you are talking about youth and this role of civil society and children, I would request Professor Rakhi Parijat from the Miranda House, where the disaster management is a very big way she is working on that. I would request Professor Rakhi, if you have any specific point to mention for engagement of the youth in the whether it's find it place in the act or not, or you wish to mention that everything is covered. Professor Rakhi.
Am I audible?
Please.
Am I audible? Thank you so much, Professor Santosh Kumar, for giving me this opportunity. Though somewhat it has been covered by Dr. Sunita Reddy. But I just would like to, because since I come from an educational institution and I've seen how things are even in the present scenario, though our administrative, I would say bodies and machineries are quite good and we have come a long way, but with such a large population, our resilience will definitely depend upon how well our, how well trained our civil society or youth are and whether they can ensure their own safety as first responders. So we have to keep in mind that we cannot afford to continue with the firefighting approach for a very long time as we continue with these new struggles and new situation, pandemic and many other disasters around the corner. So efficacy of our programs will depend on the outreach to the civil society or in specific, in our case, the youth. So we, if you want to really talk about the community-based approach, so our preparedness, we should not neglect these stakeholders. And I just make two points here. One way would be to bring in children and youth within the realm of DRR. Training programs for capacity building within these institutions and other institutions can follow. And there can be a dissemination program from there on. And secondly, this there could be an aspect of volunteerism through introduction of youth or leadership wings, like you have seen in NSS, NCC. They work in a more organized manner. So that helps a lot, because if you're unorganized, you are not able to kind of, you know, put them together, hold them together. So with guided initiatives and minimal funding, there can be an effective participation. But then somebody has to, there has to be an umbrella organization like NIDM or so, who can from time to time give these kind of trainings. That's it. That's my
observation. Thank you. Thank you very much for bringing that point. Now I will take another reflection from the civil society. Anybody else would like to raise your hand and mention? Otherwise, I will call by name. But one should not left out. That's what I have given this opportunity. Those who are attending, and probably I'm not able to see their names. But if anybody is there from civil society representation would like to mention here. No one. Thank you very much. I think civil society is covered. I can hear some sound. Anybody is willing to say something? Okay. So now I will take up this reflection, one or two reflections from NIDM, because NIDM has been discussed also. And I don't know who, Professor Surya Prakash and Professor Gupta is there. Would you like to mention here quickly one or two points which you like to mention? Overall gamut, not necessarily of NIDM or about NIDM. You have been experiencing this disaster moment, or any faculty member would like to add just quick points.
Professor Santosh.
Okay, just I would request for faculty to just hang on for some time. Prema Gopalan is here from civil society, and we wanted to have it. Yes, Prema, go ahead.
Yeah, just taking from what Vikrant and others have said, I would just like to add that the participation of organized women's groups or CBOs, and we all know that self-help groups, more than 200 million women in India are part of that. And post-COVID also, we have seen that they have really been on an autopilot, and they have contributed to the food relief and also restarting of agriculture and restarting of local markets for both food security and livelihoods. So I would request that, they are seen as partners and not beneficiaries, together with the local authorities, because we are through a UNICEF supported project in more than 50 communities, 25,000 people, mostly from vulnerable groups, given access to the free ration announced and other COVID relief schemes. So this is just an example that facilitation is very much needed for access of relief and going forward for recovery also. So they have also given, many of the groups have given loans to migrants. Yeah? So we are seeing that the gaps which are there in access, both for vulnerable groups and for women themselves, especially single-headed families and so on, because this distress is going to continue, I would request their formal place on the table as with the local authorities and also in the DDMAs together with, basically as part of the operations below the district. Yeah. So I would really request that empowerment of women as part of the community groups and also as part of, as members, we should really have a place on the table. And I would say that it needs to be about 30%, definitely. I'm not seeing it here. So if it's specified, then it needs to be implemented in that way. Thanks.
Prema, for bringing this point for empowering women as a part of the ACT process. I would take two intervention from NIDM, and then we will move on to the states and the experts. A quick intervention, Professor Anil Gupta, you were willing to say something.
Thank you, Professor Santoshji. I have been listening to the entire discourse on the previous day also and today also. And in fact, most of the reflections which has come from the learned people, because in the previous webinar, most of the people who are directly associated with the High Power Committee also and the formation of DM Bill and DM Act. So the issues which have been flagged, almost all the issues are important, and we cannot do away these issues. But the real thing that this Disaster Management Act is the umbrella act, or we can call it a framework law or framework act. So if we try to include all the important dimensions which we think which are important within the act, then probably it will lead to more complexity, whereas the framework law or framework act is expected to be more to provide more flexibility, to provide more broader gamut, and then that is supplemented by a set of regulations, set of notifications, and also set of codes and standards. Probably, so if we enlist the issues which were flagged during the previous day and today also, and then if we do some kind of audit, that what are the issues out of the point that have been flagged can be addressed by bringing in the specific notifications, can be addressed by bringing in specific regulations under the DM Act, should not be incorporated into the main body of the Act. Then those should be addressed through the regulations. Where we find that we have no other options, we cannot address those through the regulations, or they are we do not have avenues, then probably it will be required. So I would say that rather than talking of the entire revamping of the DM Act, we would say tweaking of the DM Act that is actually required. So making minor amendments, minor improvements, so that can provide avenues for incorporating the new issues which have emerged over the time, and then also with the COVID. Just quickly, for example, about the DM cycle, one of the delegates referred very important aspect of preparedness. For example, if we can bring a regulation on the framework of preparedness. And now coming to NIDM, yes, the status of an IDM remained unclear. So I think that is a very, very important issue, that for 20 years or so from the concept itself, that has been a discussion that an IDM a center of excellence, its vision also says. But we have several national institutions, and an IDM's issues are quite inferior to that. So that need to be addressed immediately. As under the various policy discourses also, it is there. So that how to address this, that has also to be seen. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Professor Santosh, let me clarify that some issue were raised about the NIDM. As per the existing act, NIDM is an autonomous institution. I don't know why there is a confusion among us, the delegates, including the NIDM faculty. Kindly read the provisions of the NIDM. It has a governing body, it has an institute body. The issue is that NIDM not convening the meetings of the statutory bodies regularly. They need to convene as early as possible the meetings of the governing body and institute body. Thank you.
The law and how an IDM is perceived, and the process how to go ahead that has also been suggested by JSDM. Thank you very much. Any additional point from NIDM other than the NIDM, this related issues, please, if you have any, then we will move ahead. Okay, there is none. So I would move now to the Assam and district disaster management authorities. Lot many deliberations happened on that particular day, on the 4th, especially on the strengthening of the district disaster management authorities. We have a representative from district disaster authorities, and also SDMAs are also looking into. Last time also Assam gave certain inputs, specific inputs, and we incorporated. Just I'm making a round that still whether the state government has come up with any new point, then we can add on, and then we will have another reflection. Assam, do you have anything to say at this moment? Assam is any district disaster management authority delegates who are still there? We see that lot many district disaster are added here. I see from Pune also, Mr. Bittal, would you like to say something? Okay. Okay, Mridu Smita, you wish to say something from Assam? Okay.
Yes, sir. I have a few submissions. There were certain observations. I had an opportunity to compare the disaster legislations of this Japan and India. So there are a few submissions that I'd like to make from my end. And also as a part of the State Disaster Management Authority, I had a few submissions. Like there should be some kind of separate laws on this disaster prevention, emergency response and disaster relief and rehabilitation under this DM Act. Since this is an overall, this is an umbrella act, so there should be certain kinds of different disaster prevention laws and emergency response laws and disaster relief and rehabilitation laws, which should govern the different prevention activities. And also there should be separate, there is a compendium of laws which has been drafted by this, which is released by NDMA in 2015. It has a set of different laws which are being mentioned in that compendium. And this, I believe that this this law, like the flood, this dam safety and other laws which are in this compendium, they should also form a part of the Disaster Management Act under the different disaster prevention laws, then emergency response laws. They should form a part of the Disaster Management Act, and there should be some kind of enforcement mechanism, like so that we can enforce these different acts in the state. There should be some provisions of that kind. So this will help us in conducting different kind of activities. Like sir, now there is a mitigation fund which has come up, but for this, for us to use this mitigation fund, and there should be some kind of laws which is under the Disaster Management Act, which helps us to not only spend this mitigation fund, also enforce some kind of things through this laws. So that should be made a part of it, sir.
Okay. You're through?
Okay, sir.
Your point. Okay, thank you so much. Now I would request the other state who is participating to kindly come up with your points, what has been said by Assam, and that the other day Bihar has mentioned many things, Maharashtra also did mention. So any other state who are willing to communicate something which they feel is necessary and not deliberated, don't go for duplication. Just if it has not been deliberated, please come again. If any state or any experts now willing to say if the state is not there?
My Colonel Supnekar from
CGPHS. Acha, acha. Okay, okay. Yes, Mr. Supnekar.
Yeah.
Yeah, there is one point regarding Center for Disaster Management in existence for such a long time. And it has suddenly lost linkage with NIDM. I think all Center for Disaster Management should function under SDMA. There is no doubt about it. But they should have full autonomy and flexibility for planning their training and to run as a resource center. I think today this is lacking, and there has to be some provision in the DMA regarding either you can call it as State Institute of Disaster Management or continue with Center for Disaster Management. And having a linkage with NIDM, we get an overall view of what is happening in India and where the information sharing is possible. So I think the old routine which a CDM was following should continue, and they should have the same linkage with the NIDM.
So इसमें act के provision से कुछ मदद तो आपको इसमें लगता है?
After NIDM, like SDRF is there in the guideline, but this Center for Disaster Management, it need not be in the act, but it can be as a rule should be developed. But for that, there has to be a guideline to support the rule. There are no guidelines regarding Center for Disaster Management also. There is no funding for Center for Disaster Management. Earlier, it was totally funded from the center, but now it is at the discretion of the state. So there has to be, for continuity and for sustainability, there has to be some guideline in form of guideline, not as an act. Otherwise, from NIDM, you can add as a SIDM also one of the provisions in the act. Thank you.
Thank you. I can see you, that you have written in the chat also. Aapne suggest kiya isko. We will take it up to the in the report. Thank you very much. Now, I would request if anybody from civil society not, then we request maybe I see Mr. Anil Sinha is also there to have his word. He contributed in the first webinar on the act. And if he is willing to say something at this point of time, very briefly, sir. Sri Anil Sinha ji, former vice chairman of BSDMA and also the draft committee.
Yeah. I hope I am audible. I hope I am audible.
Okay.
I have just a few points. I think I have already spoken on Saturday, so I will not really repeat. But I have just five points, you know, very pointedly. One is, again, I will go back to the preamble of the act, you see. You know, of course, the preamble act word is not used. I suppose that is only in the constitution, but it means the same. While prevention, mitigation, coordinated approach, preparedness, etc. are mentioned, one crucial word which seems to be missing is good governance. Is governance of disaster risk management. Because what happens, the moment we bring the word governance, it immediately incorporates, brings within its fold, you know, dimensions like transparency, accountability, equity, equitable, you know, consideration, inclusiveness, participative approach, etc., etc., all those things which define governance, and which really goes into a holistic and much more balanced kind of an approach in the implementation, that will be covered. Somehow that is not mentioned, so we should even look at the objects and reasons and amend that. Secondly, I think, again, going back to Sendai framework and SDGs and Paris Agreement, I would say Sendai framework for the first time has brought in, you know, technological disasters, you see, as a category, you see. And somehow, while, you know, today, which we have is simply too open. So one can argue that, look, this can also be included. But I think that argument may not be very helpful. So it will be good to bring consonance, you know, with this Sendai framework, and therefore bring technological disasters. Somehow I have not been able to look at the, I think the Sendai framework also talks of governance, also talks of build back better. You know, you talked about recovery, long term, you see recovery. So I think it will be good to establish a connect with the Sendai framework and SDGs, because I think Professor Janki and Harya mentioned about disasters and development. Again, this dimension, overall dimension of disaster and development is not mentioned in the preamble. You know, sorry for using the word preamble again and again, which has not been used, but I hope everyone is clear. So disasters and the connect between, the interlinkage between disaster and development, I think that must be stated right in the beginning. And then, you see, I think risk reduction, you know, leading to resilience, and that will lead to sustainable development. And when we are talking of SDGs, so I would advocate that these changes may be made so that the intention of the act becomes very, very clear. Now, the third point which I have, which has been mentioned very frankly and forthright manner, so we can mind many others, is about the NDMA, you see. I think when the discussions were taking place in the task force in Vigyan Bhavan, which was referred, I think Professor Dr. P.K. Mishra had specifically asked many, including me, views about members. And I said, okay, look, I do not know how the number 9 or 10 was decided, you see. So we must look into that, go into the files in the Ministry of Home Affairs and look into that as to what was the reason. There must have been a rationale for arriving at 9 plus 1, you see, including the chairman. Today we find that while we have 4 members and they are all eminent people, you see, no doubt, but there is no one from public health, you see. There is no one from last discussion. So therefore, I think into this aspect, the size of the country, I'm not making out a case that there have to be as many as 34 members. You see, HPC has put 34 disasters in 5 categories, you know, but then the 5 categories are too broad, you see. So maybe I think there is need for reconsideration. I'm not in a position to say go back to 9 or go to 7, but I think it needs to be reconsidered and a considered view taken on that. And same, I would echo the views of various eminent speakers on status, I think. I think status matters. You know, we are talking of governments. There are hierarchies which are inbuilt, you see. And therefore, the status matters. It is unfortunate. And I think the kind of arguments which we heard, we were never a party. I was not sitting in the MHA. You know, but top heavy and then, you know, people, you know, big baggage, et cetera, et cetera. I think those were very fallacious and loose kind of arguments. We must look into it. Let me come to the next point along with that. Why is it that we do not have uniformity in the country in terms of the constitution of SDMAs, you see? Professor V.K. Sharma mentioned very clearly that some SDMAs are there which are independent body of experts, and which is what is needed, you see. You know, we don't need cabinet subcommittees. Many of the governments, state governments, what they have in the name of the state disaster management authorities are cabinet, you know, subcommittees. Why I say? Because they are chaired by the chief ministers, there are a couple of ministers and their officers, you see. This is how you also constitute these cabinet subcommittees, you see. But cabinet subcommittee and the authority, full-fledged authority, there is a difference. Because a subcommittee would only meet a couple of times or few times during the year, while a full-fledged 24/7 independent body of experts will work 24/7, you see. They have to worry about, maybe every state will not have 34 or 30-year disasters, but then every state would have at least a dozen disasters, you see. And they are facing, you know, we can literally do that exercise and see that no state would have less than a dozen disasters. So I think, you know, it is important that in this country we bring about uniformity. There have been, I have talked to various vice chairmen from time to time. There have been arguments like we are federal state and all that. But that argument and against that, if you weigh the fact that several states which are highly disaster prone do not have effective worth the name state disaster management authorities. So I think this needs to be given, you know. Then my last point is about NIDMs. I think NIDM, the vision was is given in the high powered committees, you know, very briefly, but very holistically that vision is given. Today we must recognize the role of the academic institutions, the research institutions, you know, how they, now this has become a subject, you see. There are the PG courses. I have myself been teaching PG course in Jamia Millia, you know, in the last semester, you see. Now, if given that kind of situation, I think NIDM not only has to be a center of excellence, but it has to take that kind of a leading role of reducing the gap, you know, between policy, providing the platform where they can come together, where, you know, these things can be discussed. Many academic institutions, they have various seminars and conferences, but they remain with in their own tables. I don't think they ever travel to the policymakers, you see. So what is the point? I think thanks to Mr. Jindal that he clarified, it is good, but I just like to humbly put to Mr. Jindal that I think there is more to it than what meets the eye, you see. And we must go into it. Why? You see, now 15 years on, you see, when the NIDM was constituted, why it has not become, you know, a kind of a center, international center of excellence. We need to push it, you know. We all need to push it, you see. And, you know, really take it to another level, because look at what has happened. One pandemic has totally crippled the whole country, you see. You know? So that is why I think the demands are too high, and the emerging situation, unfolding scenarios are not going to be easy. Looking at overlapping disasters, complex disasters, concurrent disasters, and there is no indication that things are going to get simpler with climate change and with pandemic, you know, being a long story, etc., etc. So that is it. I think I have come to the and last point, you know, is that private sector. I think private sector is a great resource. Look at their contribution in the Indian economy, you see. Today, if the economy has taken a beating, that is because the private sector has taken a beating. And private sector has taken a beating because the migrant workers, you see, that kind of a problem which came, you know, it has never been seen. It was not seen by anyone, you see. So we need institutions, you know, which can go in detail and in depth into issues like this and the likely scenarios. And unless until we are, you know, there are reports in Indian Express and many national, you know, newspapers that big companies have been sending chartered flights to get their migrant workers. So it is not just a question of getting a worker. They are highly skilled workers, you see. And factories cannot replace those workers so very immediately. Now, where private sector holds the key to the whole country and the economy, the private sector, unfortunately, does not find a mention in the whole Disaster Management Act, you see. Even if there is a word somewhere, I think we need to give it much more prominence. It contributes something like, you know, 55-60% to the whole economy, you see. So I think that. And last point, you know, the volunteerism. We have talked of youth. You mentioned about youth specifically. Volunteerism, we need to look at it entirely. I mentioned this. Let us look at the in Australia, New Zealand, USA, Singapore, Japan, Europe, where people like you and me can become volunteers. You see, in pandemic, you should have the freedom to go and work as a volunteer while your service interest, your salary interest, your other administrative interest as a professor in NIDM or any other institution of the government, ministry or the department or the PSU, they are protected, you see, which is what happened. Because all kinds of specialties, you know, whether accountancy to law to anything, they are needed in these kinds of situations. You know, all kinds of situations are. I make this very fervently that let us nationally take a fresh look at the whole concept. Yes, yes. Concept of volunteerism. And thank you, Santosh, for giving me this time. I think it's been a wonderful discussion. Thank you so much, Yusuf. God bless.
No, thank you very much for giving this kind of additional 5 points today than that you gave on the other day, that Saturday webinar. Before I request from the our own colleague or maybe from NDMA to close that up, okay, because we are reaching to the time of closing 5:30, but 10 minutes is still left. So before that, if anybody would like to say or would think that they have not been able to, they have not got the opportunity to speak, whether state government or district disaster authority or civil society, last chance, but one intervention we would like to have before.
From Rise Infinity Foundation.
Okay, please go ahead.
Yeah. So we have.
I will come to you later.
Yeah.
Yeah, please go
ahead. I'm Kiran Shaiva from the Rise Infinity Foundation, based in Mumbai, and we're part of the Jeeva Vrat initiative with UNICEF. We have been running a virtual call center to help and track migrants who are traveling across the country, obviously, mostly from Maharashtra, but also working in partnership with a large number of other partners to help and support wherever possible in other areas as well. I have actually maybe two points to really make over here. Number one was, of course, the most important, that was the amount of resources that have gone into supporting the migrant travelers. I think, you know, according to newspaper reports, there was some 11,000 crores that was given to support migrant travelers. And somewhere, somehow, we don't seem to have any idea that if that was available, you know, what happened? Because we've had speakers before who spoke about and spoke about coordination, that how is this money being utilized if it has been kept aside? And why our social sector have spent so much? How is that being kind of seen? Because if you think about the strengthening of private sector, then I think, you know, the social sector has been equally impacted, if not more, because on one hand, there is no money available at all for core needs, for core requirements. And on the other hand, we are putting in whatever we have, both time and effort. We spoke about volunteerism, both time and effort into supporting our work with the migrant laborers. So I think, you know, on one hand is this allocation of funds.
So any specific suggestion for the act or the regulations, please?
One, to support the, if money is being announced, is available, then how is it being utilized? And second is from a strengthening purposes, how is the civil society and the social sector being strengthened to support during these efforts? We cannot be only be getting raising funds through CSR and other activities if a lot of money is going into the PM CARES fund. You know, how is money being allocated for the social sector? I think that's really the important thing.
So your comment is that social sector inclusion for the support and taking actions for the, that's what the intervention.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for making your point for the inclusion of social sector. Hello? As well, along with the price. Yes, please.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah.
This is Suresh.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, this is Suresh Maniasalam. I'm the former program officer with Tamil Nadu Tsunami Resource Center as a coordination network officer. And I'm also part of the COAST, which Karen was talking about.
Yeah, yeah, please. Tell the...
So recently, I've been moderating along with Mahatma Gandhi National Council for Rural Education in promoting the plans for post-COVID campus planning preparedness. And recently we had one state level seminar for all the principals. To my surprise, many of the principals do not have the basics about DM concepts and the DM Act and all this things what we are talking about. And when I was talking about every institution should have a disaster management plan consisting of all the resources and how to communicate, and that was a new thing. Hello, I'm not.
What I'm saying, that is there in the act. what we say, that DM plan and inclusion that is there. If you wish to add on with the COVID experience, what is new thing to be added or not added or self-suffice, add if you suggest something. Your voice is gone.
So it is in the act, it is there, but my point is how we are going to practically make it happen.
Okay.
So that,
okay.
So that there should be some mechanism. So act is there. I have seen what I explained, but they could not follow me. No?
Okay.
So should, yeah, that is what my point is. So that for us to make further preparedness and make it uniform in all the states.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Hello, Professor Santoshi. Hello.
Apna point quickly rakhiye Ranjini ji.
Thank you so much to give me time. I want to say one thing very specific, that is Disaster Management Act is the umbrella act. We all agree upon this view. So my one and the only key suggestion is, in our academic institutions, basically in secondary education and higher educations, Disaster Management Act sales should be compulsorily opened, please.
Okay.
This is my one and key suggestion. If
you
feel, I will send it to you in writing also. Thank you, Santoshi.
Please, please.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I request all the distinguished delegates who have participated and they have said something.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. You have contributed. Everyone has contributed, and still you feel that something has been left out. It is not there. In 2 days' time, I would request you to pen down your ideas, and send it to NIDM so that we can collate your ideas and put the form of the report, and we will submit it to the NDMA and the working group and to Ministry of Home Affairs. I think last intervention, of the day, we will take from. NDMA at this stage, we are closing, and then we will have a winding up. I hope the delegates are through with their comments, and I'm requesting this time is running out, so they can already submitting their, I have made the request for submitting their viewpoint in writing to us. I would request before I go to NDMA, may I request the Joint Secretary Sri Sanjeev Kumar Jindal ji to express his views on the deliberations happened today, if any, please.
Thank you, Santosh ji. We have a lot more suggestions today, and the committees are already there. So I am sure they will look into all the recommendations. One thing I just want to reflect upon couple of points were raised that there is no coordination. I am sorry to find that this point is made out. The coordination mechanism is already there in the act at the national level, at the state level. At the national level, we have a national executive committee to coordinate with all the concerned ministries. Similarly, we have a state executive committee at the state level and district disaster management authority at the district level. If some coordination is not happen somewhere, it's the fault of the people managing those institutions, not because of the act. Thank you.
Thank you very much for clarifying this, that how the coordination mechanism things are already in place, that only thing we need to actually translate this act into action. This is very interesting, and I have also been getting messages from different parts of the country. And somebody has suggested, which I would like to just quickly mention 2-3 points here to the all the audience who are delegates here. Who are. One, they are talking about that MISHAP is already written in the act, and MISHAP defines this means accidents, and that accident could be road accident or industrial accidents. So that should be taken into perspective, that how mission should be unfolded. Is number one. Number two, that we are talking about inclusion of transgender in terms of very, very clearly, and other speakers have also mentioned this point. Third thing which have come up from the other sources, one is inclusion of transboundaries disaster, how that should be addressed as part of the Government of India rule of business. And that will go, and it is definitely, it has been defined somewhere, but somebody has suggested that it should go in the right spirit of the act, that how proactively Government of India can also help other countries in need in the disaster. And the fourth and the last point, when we are talking about inclusion of women in the state authorities or the national authorities, as a kind of a point that how this is maybe my point, you can say that how women be given, as a prime minister is saying about the leadership role of women, this would be possible when we start looking at the state DMAs, DDMAs, and also at the NDMAs, that how that can incorporate as a kind of a rule of business. So this was all. I'm not summarizing the entire thing which had happened. We have noted, and everybody has listened to this, and they are review to this. And I would request, before I request ED and IDM to close, to give the closing remarks, I would request if any point of suggestions coming from NDMA, either Dr. Vatsa or Kamal Kishoreji or anybody whom they think they wish to actually comment upon this, or please, you are welcome.
Thank you very much, Professor Santosh. I'll take the floor while Krishnaji prepares himself to have the last word from EMA. I think it's been hugely, hugely useful. So I would like to first of all thank NIDM for putting this together. So what we discussed on Saturday and what we discussed today, between them, I noted something like 50 points to be addressed. 48 points precisely. Out of 48, 18 points just from Mr. Anil Sinha alone. So all very valuable. And I can tell you that now I understand why this attempt to review the act, you know, has been started and stopped so many times, because it's such a daunting task. So I feel a little nervous that in a very limited time, how we will address all of these comments and come up with something which is really a 21st century act in terms of our proposed review for its amendment. I just want to make three points. These are not a summary of what has been said. My first point is that there has to be some sort of an internal coherence in the act. While it is good to sort of go by article, but if it doesn't have a clear thinking in it, it doesn't have clarity that underpins whatever amendment, then, you know, it will again be an unwieldy document. Somebody talked about its readability, its accessibility. It will go in the wrong direction. So I think we really have to achieve that coherence from within the act. And some of the things, I'll give you just one example. For example, the act requires the National Disaster Management Plan to be prepared and updated annually. When we it took 10 years to do the first draft, and when it was put out in the public domain, there was a request from the academic institutions and civil society organizations to give them at least 6 to 8 months to review it, to have wide consultations to do it. It's clearly not very practical, you know. So is it really necessary that the whole of national plan, disaster management plan, need to be reviewed annually? Maybe it's response elements as we learn more, but not the whole. So I think that there are some things which are just like they're there, but it doesn't provide the sort of means for actually accomplishing that. The second point I want to make is that this is a Disaster Management Act. This is not a National Disaster Management Authority Act. You know, it is about the functions of disaster management across the country, from top to top national level to the local level, and horizontally across all the departments, all the development sectors and all. So we really have to think about it in terms of functions rather than focus on one particular institution and so on. In that context, I also sense some sort of a cognitive dissonance. There was a very clear demand that, you know, you decentralize, bring in PRIs, bring in ULBs into the fold of it, civil society, all very great ideas, very good ideas. But at the same time, you know, elevate the NDMA, make it stronger, make it coordinate everything. Although the current act you know, irrespective of the level of members, does not require NDMA to coordinate. It's the National Executive Committee led by the Ministry of Home Affairs which coordinates implementation. NDMA is not mandated to coordinated response as per the current act. But there is demand from people to, I sense, particularly in today's conversation, that is the second thing. The third thing, a more philosophical question and a fundamental question, is talking about disaster and development linkages. You know, I started working in this field 25 years ago. The first book I ever read was written by Fred Kuehne in 1983 on disasters and development. So as a rhetoric, yes, we have to do it. You know, who can disagree with that? But can we have some examples, some comparative examples from other countries? There are academic institutions that have written books on it, but none of them address how to do that in a meaningful way. You know, one possibility is that we include that as an overarching ambition in the preamble, as Anil Sinha sir was saying. We could do that. The other is to how do you translate that into specifics? You know, I would really like to see examples of how this can be done. Here again, there is a little tension there. So if you want to make disaster and development come together, then you have to integrate in the developmental laws. You know, all of us participating in this conversation probably have read only one law, which is the Disaster Management Act. There are other laws as well. What about, you know, Water Management Act? What about Power Provision Act? What about, and so on. So, I mean, how do you make sure that, you know, I mean, you want to sort of mainstream it in development sectors, but you want to make the Disaster Management Act an omnibus act, you know, even more friendly, unfriendly, and even more difficult to implement. So I think these are some of the tensions we will need to resolve. It's a tough task before us, but I think with all your support, I think we are up for it. We'll take it to its logical conclusion. And so we've had these two conversations, but from the side of the committee that has been tasked to look at this review, we are open to receive suggestions in writing. Any of the members of the committee you want to speak to, you should feel free to reach out to us. We are very open to that. I would have to close talking about the pandemic. I think the pandemic is, we are still in the middle of it. Let's not start passing judgments on it. Somebody said a pandemic has thrown the whole country in a disarray. It's not a pandemic. It's the pandemic of the century. The last time such a thing happened was 100 years ago. At that time, neither our world was as interconnected or as interdependent. So what we are looking at is truly phenomenally big and unprecedented. In a country of 1.4 billion people, how many people have had problems of getting access to milk, fruit, vegetables, medicines? You know, we opened the supply chain within weeks or within days of enforcing the lockdown. It is not a small achievement. You know, so I think it is very fashionable to have to do self-flagellation, but when you look closely, there are many, many successes to be celebrated, but I will not celebrate that because we are right in the middle of the disaster. We have to join hands to deal with it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kamal Kishoreji, the chairman of the draft committee of the Disaster Management Act and member of the NDMA, for giving insights and also putting forward his point in terms of the COVID-19, that how India, government of India, have been successfully able to handling, actually, I mean, the process. And it's a huge challenge before us and hugely decapacitating exercise for long, long time it is going on. And so the how collectively with the state government and government of India are working on it. Friends, thank you very much to all of you, especially National Disaster Authority and Ministry of Home Affairs, for giving National Institute of Disaster Management an opportunity to organize these two workshops.
Would Dr. Krishnawats like to say something? We would like to hear him.
Dr. Vatsa, are you there?
I really enjoyed the discussion and so many different opinions and know, let's now get down to doing the real work. So thank you very much. You know, I don't have much to add. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vatsa. You had already flagged 7-8 points on the first day, and the discussion followed afterwards. Entire deliberations went on, and all the delegates who came with their ideas and how the Disaster Management Act looked at, they deliberated upon, along with the Ministry of Home Affairs and the National Institute of Disaster Management. Personally, I extend my heartfelt thanks to all the delegates who participated and contributed both the days, the 4th and the 6th today. All the stalwarts, I'm not naming because everyone is there who had guided us and led us, and they've been teacher also for us. And so all of you are very, very important for this exercise, and you have been on our request, you accepted this invitation and contributed. I greatly, profusely thank to the NDMA, Dr. Vatsa, and Mr. Kamal Kishore and all his team, their teams that they cooperated, and especially the Mr. Sanjeev Jindal, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Home Affairs, who has been always supporting NIDM in one way or the other way, all the time he's there for us. I extend my heartfelt thanks to all of you. And now I request Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, Executive Director of NIDM, to give the closing remarks and announce the closes of this particular webinar. Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, please.
Thank you, Dr. Santosh Kumar. For last 2 hours, it has been a very fruitful discussion. In fact, both the webinars have brought too many points, which a lot of them are implementable and very, very pertinent for the revision. However, the distinction between what is need to be included in the Act and what needs to be referred to in the guidelines or rules and regulations, that distinction I think committee will do. What we will request the participants, whosoever has a point to give, if they can give it their point against a particular section and subsection, where they want that point to be included or excluded or the intervention to be made. That way we'll be able to give much better comments to the committee so that it is easily understood by them and the context in which it is being spoken to. With this, I thank everyone and Dr. Santosh Kumar for moderating the whole session. And I thank you members of NDMA, Mr. Kamal Kishore and Dr. Krishna Vatsa and Sanjeev Kumar Jindalji, Joint Secretary, Disaster Management, for being with us throughout the webinar. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much. Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, Executive Director in NIDM, who gave us this opportunity to moderate that whole the 2 webinars. I'm extremely grateful to you and that you entrusted this responsibility to us. I'm grateful to my team as well, though Dr. Anuradha Maurya and Balaji, who's been supporting, and from child-centric disaster response, Dr. Raka and Ranjan, who have been constantly noting down all the points and making this report. Thank you very much to all of you, and especially Mr. Major Bindal, Major Jindal Bindal, for giving me. So we can, with the permission, I can say that for the closure announcement, should I do that with the permission of the ED and IDM?
Yes, please.
Thank you very much. Now, friends and delegates, have a very good evening, and have a great time ahead. And certainly we will come up with give it this report, and you, as announced by member NDMA and also by ED and IDM, please submit your report as quickly as possible to us, your point which you are thinking, and submit it to us so that it can get incorporated. Thank you very much. And I announce the closure of the workshop. Thank you very much once again to all of you.